Assalamu alaikum and greetings of peace. This is Sumaya Khalifa with the Islamic Speakers Bureau of Atlanta, welcoming you to our amazing Ramadan inspiration. And we are so lucky and privileged and honored to welcome our own beloved Shaykh, our own beloved teacher, scholar, friend, writer, and everything in between, our own Shaykh Muhammad bin Yahya al-Ninowy. Shaykh Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sumaya, thank you so much for having me again. And a very beautiful day, inshallah, to all of you here in Georgia and throughout the nation and throughout the world. It's a pleasure to be again on the Islamic Speakers Bureau of Atlanta's platform and to share a platform with our dear teacher and mentor, Sister Sumaya Khalifa, and her beloved team, taking also the opportunity today to wish Sumaya especially a very happy birthday. And wish her all the best and pray that the creator of all keeps blessing her and her team with the good work that she's doing, accept that from her and multiplies it and grant us all the opportunity to benefit from the beautiful spiritual, humanitarian, and compassionate approach that she's leading the organization in and reaching to the hearts and minds of our fellow brothers and sisters in this nation and beyond. Ramadan is a beautiful month, and it's very important that we look at Ramadan in a way that is not theoretical. And the Ramadan has a purpose. So does all of our worship. A lot of people think that especially within the faith, that worship itself is an objective. And they use the word sometimes erroneously to make it, to have that reductionist sort of view on it, where وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, I have created jinn and ins so that they worship. So they take from that worship is the objective, and worship is but the means, not the objective. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِن قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The whole purpose, you have siyam prescribed on you. The purpose, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, at the end of the ayah. So that you actually reach a level of conscientiousness with the Creator, of conscientiousness, of present, being present with the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that you're refined and illuminated, and also you become that illuminated being. And that's why I said in this Ramadan, very important that you introduce yourself to your heart. In the hustle and bustle of life, we oftentimes forget our hearts. We just let our mind rule the day. And especially this in this time of pandemic, it's important for us to actually introduce ourselves to our hearts, discover your heart, introduce yourself to your heart, and maybe shake the hands of your heart, if there is to say, if there is such a thing. Discover the good things that you have, and discover the not so good things maybe that need improvement. And for the good things that you have, smile to yourself. Right, we've always talked about the prophetic instructions to smile in the face of everybody, because this is an act of charity. Your smile is an act of charity to society, is an act of charity to yourself as well. So time is time also to smile to the good things in your heart and make peace with your heart. Let's have a good relationship. And I said that's very, what's very important also in making peace with our heart is that we learn to teach our sorrows and pains and grudges and all the negative stuff that we may have, we learn to teach them how to fly away, so that they are free from the prison of our hearts. They don't belong there to start with, so don't keep them there. Among the most beautiful things in the Ramadan, obviously, is allowing us to actually be free and allowing us to actually pray with the whole levels of prayers, Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. Iman, Islam, and Ihsan. Remember the hadith of Jibreel that came and asked, first, what is Iman? What is Islam? What is Ihsan, right? And what is faith? What is practice? And what is Ihsan? And the whole point of Ihsan is that it comes after faith, after Iman. Iman, if we can say it's orthodoxy, and Islam is orthopraxy, but that should not be what faith is all about, just orthodoxy and then orthopraxy. It leads us to Ihsan, which is illumination, which is refinement of that human character, which is maximal, reaching the maximal potential of the human being that Allah created you with. Every human being is created in the best of ways and the most perfect of ways. As the Quran insists, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. And therefore, since Ramadan comes to ask us to fast, to ask us to abstain from food and drinks from Fajr to sunset, asked us to also watch what we say, right? Make sure that what you're saying is absolutely, obviously in general situations, you're supposed to only always say the truth. But especially here in Ramadan, if you don't have anything positive to say, you don't say anything. Charity, there's a special charity attached to Ramadan that we're supposed to be doing. All these things that are, and then Ramadan is the month of the Quran, the month of praying at night, the month of all these meditation at night. That's what praying at night is, basically. Taraweeh or so, you start meditating at night, especially in the last 10 days. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always woke up his family and kept praying at night. All these things are sort of like a school that's intensive. It's an intensive course to introduce you to your heart, to who you really are. And to who you really are in this, and vis-a-vis where you put yourself in this life, but who you really are, where you came from, and where you're going after this dimension. Your universal GPS, per se, or beyond, you know, meta-universal GPS of who you truly are as a spiritual being. And that's why fasting is there. Fasting is to make us reach that potential, because you remember, when fasting, the Creator is not in need of us starving. He's not in need of us being thirsty. That doesn't help him, but it helps us if it now brings us to a level of realizing, all right, number one, I'm doing this out of faith, because I am fasting because he asked me to do so and it's good for me, but it's also out of love. I want to actually do something out of love of him. And I love him and he asked me to do that, so that's good, I'm going to do that. And then also out of the prophetic, walking the prophetic footsteps, and also, so this fasting leads me to لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ that the Quran speaks about. And لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ that the Quran speaks about is that you become more transparent, more conscientious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more conscientious of the things that are around us, more conscientious of who you are, and more transparent with who you really are. So you don't just burn the time that you have, which is the most important and the most worthy after faith. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. That's why the power of prayer in this month of fasting is unimaginably powerful. And Siyam comes to sort of removes all the barriers and all the interception and all the interruption from our prayers. Fasting cleanses us, so therefore now the heart speaks to the Creator. It's no longer just the mind or the tongue speaking, but the heart is speaking. It is now a much more transparent human being. That's the whole point of Siyam. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it for us. He says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Siyam, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ means that you actually become virtuous people. Virtuous people. That's the whole point. you become virtuous. It's not about just feeling with the needy or not feeling with the needy. If there's a needy person who's fasting, he's already needy. He already feels all the need there is. It's not just that. It is actually just to be virtuous. And virtue is a noble trait of character. Like it's a natural disposition. It's ingrained. It's deeply entrenched in our character. Virtue is unlike a habit. You may have a habit of drinking tea or drinking coffee, let's say, but that's not what virtue is. Virtue is not a habit. Let's say when the Quran tells us, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you may be honest, transparent. But honesty is not like drinking tea, for example, as a habit. Honesty is to believe, to notice, to value, to desire, to choose, to expect, to act, and to react, always in a way that's consistent with that. It's a deeply rooted mindset. It's a wholehearted acceptance of this concept of لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, theoretically and in an applicable way as well. Let me give you an example here. Honesty, for example, that the Quran speaks about, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, the whole point of Siyam is that you actually not just harbor, you all have it, alhamdulillah, but improve it and understand what it is and move from fairly virtuous, let's say, to better, much more than just fairly virtuous. Honesty, for example, is not something that's based on a wisdom that honesty is the best policy. That's not a virtue. Al-Quran Kareem wants us to have honesty as a virtue, not as a calculation that, well, honesty is the best policy, so that's why I'm honest. That's not virtuous. Virtue or honesty is not based on out of fear of being caught. I have to be honest, otherwise, you know, I'm caught. No, that's not a virtue here. That's still a calculated intellectual approach to doing things. Honesty here, the virtue of honesty that the Quran wants us to harbor and actually improve during fasting is the ability to recognize that to do other than honesty would be dishonest, period. And would not be pleasing the Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the first place. So, Al-Quran Kareem wants us to realize that saying a lie is a basis for actually who we are as honest human beings in our relationship with God, subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? It's important to harbor the generosity, for example, that the Quran speaks about. Generosity is not when you give because everybody else is giving. That's not the virtue of being generous. Generosity is not when you give in a fundraiser because you're under peer pressure. Generosity is not when you give because generosity is because to do otherwise would not be generous, and that's not you. Al-Quran wants to have that as an intrinsic, natural disposition in you. And that natural disposition is pleasing the Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like Ali radiallahu anhu says, Al-Judu ma kana ibtida'an. Generosity is that which comes from a natural disposition. Amma ma kana an istijda'. But if somebody asks you to be generous, that's almost, he says, extortion. It's not generosity. It has nothing to do with generosity. And this month of Siyam, we can harness that power that this month brings us to actually move or to put the fasting in the Quranic track where it belongs. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kutiba alaykum al-siyam. Siyam was prescribed upon you, la'allakum tattaqoon, so that you may reach that virtuous state. And we have many virtues here. Honesty is one of them. Generosity is one of them. In the month of fasting specifically, obviously it's a training for the rest of life. But that's the whole point. If we fail, if we stay just kutiba alaykum siyam, you're supposed to fast, and we introduce or we interpret fasting in a reductionist way, that it is abstaining from food and drinks from fajr to sunset, we have cut the ayah right in the middle, and we have not continued. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. We have then reduced our faith to orthodoxy and maybe partial orthopraxy, but we will never then reach the full potential of the faith, which is illumination and ihsan. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant us the opportunity to harness that in the Ramadan and to be the human beings that Allah Azza wa Jal asked us to be, in the best of ways. And in this difficult time that our nation is facing with the pandemic and the increased fatalities, and also the whole world, it's important to take this month of Ramadan to pray selflessly. The whole point of Ramadan here also is to make us reach a selfless point and to pray selflessly for everybody who's suffering, for everything that's suffering, to pray selflessly for the for all humanity and all living things, and with that to include ourselves. But even if we don't include ourselves selflessly praying, the creator of all knows. He likes us to display, not to genuinely display, our belief of needing and to be selfless before him. And he rewards on selflessness that which he doesn't on selfishness. So I think it's important for us to take that opportunity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this blessed month to show his love and mercy to all those who are suffering, to guide us and then bless us all. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad.
Our beloved Shaykh, thank you so much. Your words soften our hearts and remind us of what's important in life is for us to be connected to ourselves, first of all. And this month is a training camp for us to be close to God, to become more God conscious, and to see who we are and how can we improve. Jazakallah khair for being with us, for your words of wisdom, your words that moved us, and we just can't thank you enough. Thank you all for joining in and being with us today. Hope that you benefited from our beloved Sheikh's words as much as we have. And may all the goodness come out of our talk today. Jazakum Allah khair, and inshallah, we'll see you all soon. And may you have a blessed day, week, and the rest of the month. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.